Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you so much for joining us, and feel free to grab a seat. I'm delighted to be out here on this wonderful, warm, sunny day and talking to you all and greeting you for our annual telehealth town hall event. It's wonderful to see a lot of familiar faces, and I'm really excited about the session that we're going to have today. We're going to start off with a presentation from Dr. Gregg Meyer, who is going to give us the big picture perspective on the partners' healthcare and his perception on the role of telehealth as it relates to some of our important objectives. Then we're going to have that'll be from about 3:40 till about 4 o'clock, and then we're going to have an open panel discussion with three panelists, which I will moderate, to talk about some of the implications of the work that we've done here already and the perspective that Dr. Meyer is going to provide. So it is my great pleasure, and I won't take any longer of your time, to introduce Gregg Meyer, who is the Chief Clinical Officer at Partners Healthcare. Before that, Gregg really led all the clinical efforts at the Dartmouth-Hitchcock Health System. He was a major leader at the Agency for Healthcare Research Quality, HRQ. And in my mind, he's one of the most forward-thinking healthcare leaders that I've had the pleasure to work with. And his perspective on how he sees telehealth in an integrated delivery system related to healthcare, I think, is vital. So I'm really delighted to have him and excited to hear what he has to say. Thank you, Gregg.
Thank you, Lou.
If you want to use that, great. Thank you.
So let me begin by saying that for those of you over on this side of the room, all the slides are over here. And so feel free to move if you're going to have a hard time seeing these. There's not a lot of fine print, and I'll happy to explain my way through them, but you may miss a little bit of something there. So my job is just to provide a framework for us to have some questions and answers. So I hope all of you think of really good, hard questions to ask the panelists. You know, my advice to you is save all the hard questions for the three people on the right side of the table. Okay, the slow pitchers over the plate should come over here, to me. So thank you, Lee and Sarah, for having me here today. And what I'm going to do is, again, just provide a framework for us to think about all this. And one of the things that I'm always reminded of is to be very aware of history. And in some ways, it's quite ironic for somebody to give a talk about telehealth and telemedicine here at the MGH. And you will see in my slides that I have stolen shamelessly from folks like Lee and Joe Kavidar, and from Ron Dixon, and from others. But I also will share freely as well. And so, thinking about coming here and giving a talk on telehealth is a little bit daunting, because in some ways it's like being invited to Mount Sinai to talk about the Ten Commandments, or it's about invited to the Ether Dome, to talk about the history of anesthesia, because you're going to the place where a lot of this stuff started. And I always remind myself, that as much as things change, there's a lot that remains the same. And the truth of the matter is that things, that began here have really changed dramatically over time, and at the same time, our role is just to be stewards in that next step of its evolution. The one thing I'd remind you of here is there's that book. It's kind of an interesting book, and I got introduced to this through some slides that Joe Kavidar shared with me. And it's a book that was published in 1914. And the cover of the book is interesting, because what the cover of the book shows is it shows the things that were absolutely fantastical that were going on in 1914. And it shows a picture of the Wright brothers airplane. Wow, that was really amazing. A picture of a tractor plowing a field. Wow, how amazing there. It also shows a picture of a bicycle looking more like a bicycle as we would know it, instead of the big one-wheeled contraptions. And so this was a period of time with a lot of wonder to it, that there was a lot changing really, really rapidly. And there was this book that came out, Tom Swift and the Photo Telephone. And the notion here was that, oh my goodness, there's going to be this amazing invention that we're going to have a phone, but you're actually going to be able to see somebody. And in 1914, that was pretty fantastical. And the reality is, for healthcare in some ways, that came true. For in the late 1950s, with the work of Ken Bird here at Mass General, pulmonologist here at Mass General, who set up you know, a telemedicine clinic over at Logan Airport. And I think many of you, how many people here know that story? Many of you, you know that story incredibly well. Some of you actually probably participated in aspects of it. But, you know, that's why coming here is a bit daunting, because it started here. And I'm going to run through a framework on the past, the present, and the future. And you notice kind of the slide headings are the same, because I want us to have a framework for thinking about it. And the first thing to think about is well, what is the use case? Why did he do that? Why did he come up with that? And when you look at the spectrum of care here, and on the left side it goes from patient and family care, the care that their patients provide for to themselves to keep themselves healthy, all the way over to quaternary care, the kind of care that's provided at a place, you know, like MGH in the ICUs here. When you look across that spectrum, you basically the use case early on for telemedicine was providing care where it was needed, but really hard to access or not available. And so it really focused on what we kind of mainly call secondary and tertiary care. That was really what it was focusing on to begin with here. And when you think about that, the real use case was geography. Geography is just a problem that was hard to solve up until then, and that 4 miles between Logan Airport and the Mass General Emergency Room, you know, that was a real problem, especially for patients who had an acute medical issue. So this notion that you could solve it by beaming images back and forth and beaming audio back and forth via TV studio was very, very powerful. And the one point I think is important to remind ourselves of is that use case continues today. And so, you know, CREST is a program that one of my colleagues at Dartmouth, Sarah Pletcher, set up, which is a network that includes 18 critical access hospitals and community hospitals in New Hampshire and Vermont. It brings care at a very high level in places that otherwise couldn't access it. When people have to drive literally 45 minutes an hour and 15 minutes to get to care, the notion that you can make specialty care local for them is still powerful today. And so that use case remains, but that was the real driver initially was geography. You know, when you look at the equipment was really high tech. Not only that, it was really custom. Like, these things were built just for this. You know, it wasn't that these were mass produced and you could go to Radio Shack or Best Buy and get, you know, some of these consoles or these cameras and just put them all together and plug and play. These were all custom built. And you can see that, you know, when we look at it now, wow, it looks so crude. But I always remind myself, when I go to the Smithsonian and I look at the Wright Brothers airplane, you know, I always have two reactions to it, hanging up there, you know, above you when you walk in the atrium. The one reaction is, oh my God, that thing is so primitive. And that's what all you're thinking. Like, you think, it's like, wow, that looks kind of primitive. Like, I Skype on my iPhone, you know, that's all. But on the other hand, yeah, the Wright Brothers airplane was primitive, but it flew. But it flew, right? It was amazing. It was amazing because it was just, and in many ways, that's, you know, the reaction I have when I look at these pictures. Wow, it's really primitive, but wow, it worked. And that was a pretty cool thing. And the technology, it facilitated an interaction. It just made that interaction possible. When you think about the services that were provided, they were transactional. They were, let's provide a given service at this moment because there is a need. And it was active, and that involved some work. It involved the folks who were trying to set it up and who were coordinating that telemedicine visit. And you can see here, you know, looking at an EKG strip, again, being beamed over from Logan Airport, or maybe from the VA hospital up north of here, where it also had a similar telemedicine connection. When you think about the focus was acute care. It was care that was needed at that time, the patient having a heart attack, patient short of breath, shows up at the airport. And it was really provider-driven. A provider triage case and said, yeah, I think you need this service. I'm going to go ahead and do this, as opposed to, I'm going to put you in an ambulance and send you through the tunnel over here to the MGH. Now fast forward to the present day, and you know, Bodhisattva taught us that do not dwell on the past, do not dream of the future, concentrate the mind on the present moment. And I think one of the things that's very remarkable to me coming back from Dartmouth, where I had the pleasure of overseeing the telehealth efforts there, is that when you look across the landscape, you know, at the Mass General and the partners writ large, there is a lot going on. There is a lot going on here. And so, you know, you can see up there that, you know, the way population health management is starting to use e-visits, and there's Ron Dixon with his headset, and you can see on the upper right the e-consults that we're doing back and forth between providers. In the lower right there is our own Keith Lillimo on the Grand Rounds website doing provider to provider consults, and you'll see on the lower left side here, there's this very nice framework that was developed here for thinking about, you know, real time versus delayed and synchronous and asynchronous communications, how all these pieces fit in. And there's a lot going on here. So that's the terrific thing. And say, well, what's the use case now? And I think the use case now is when we look at kind of that patient trajectory, and the use case now is really focusing a lot on those high cost, high needs patients, those patients who are in our population health management program who have chronic conditions who are going to benefit from these interactions. But it also is working on minding the gaps, because it's those gaps between primary care and secondary care, secondary care, tertiary care, and back to home care where patients fall through the cracks, and there are some wonderful tools that we have now that can be applied to that. And so the other piece of the use case is population health management and referral care. And when you talk about what is the strategy for partners healthcare, I always remind people, I spend a lot of my time working with Tim Ferriss and others on population health management. I love that work. It is really important to the future of partners healthcare. It is important to the future of the Mass General. With that said, this is the Mass General. We are always going to be a tertiary and quaternary referral place. So there's always going to be that balance. And so when people say, well, you know, boy, how what's the right way to pay for healthcare? There is no single right way to pay for healthcare. We're going to get paid many different ways. And I think when you think about, well, we may get paid fee-for-service for some things, for referral care, but we're going to have populations that we manage and have shared savings, and maybe we're going to take on more risk and capitation. And you can get awfully confused saying, what should we focus on? What should we do? Forget about how we get paid. We're always going to get paid in a lot of different ways. That's true today, it's going to be true tomorrow, it's going to be true a decade from now. But what you should remember is that no matter how you get paid, if you do a really good job of taking care of patients, if you do it in a patient-centered way, you meet their needs, and by the way, you provide that service efficiently, you win. And so when you think about all those different ways where we might, the ways we might get paid, telehealth can help us in each one of those. And it is today. It's making contributions in every one of these. When you think about the equipment, we still think it's kind of high tech, but it's not so wowing as it was before. It's not really as custom. It's not, we're not building one-offs like we used to. But there's niche companies that are putting these pieces together, like the scales that you see there or the blood pressure cuffs. When you think about the type of services, it's not just transactional. It's not just providing a service when it's needed. And it's not just active. It's not just me as a primary care doctor saying, I want you to schedule an e-visit with me. It's also passive. And this is kind of the monitoring work that's been done in heart failure and other places. So there are a lot of different programs going on here. And again, this is just a view of what's going on across partners. And not surprisingly, you can see the bulk of this activity comes from the MGH and the Connected Health work. And the Brigham is starting to move forward on this as well. You know, what is the focus? Why is it out there? And it's out there. It's largely driven by convenience. And also driven by chronic care. So it's how can we make it easy for patients to access our services at a time and a place that suits them? And oh, by the way, how can we also focus in on those high needs patients who get chronic care and make them part of our system? And it's now driven not just by the provider, but driven by a team. So it used to be that, in that Logan Medical Station, that the person they were talking to on the other end was always a doctor. Now it may be a care manager in one of our practices, it may be a nurse, it may be a health coach, it may be a therapist. And oh, by the way, sometimes it's even going to be a doctor, but not always. I want to talk a little bit now about the future, and Yogi Berra reminded us that it's tough to make predictions, especially about the future, so don't hold my feet to the fire on this. But what I would say is when I start thinking about where do I think that the next opportunities are, I think they're trying to pull two worlds together. And the one world is the world that we know best, and that's the world on the right side of the slide here. And that's the world of medical care. That's providing care for people who need it. But there's that whole other piece of our health system we don't talk a whole lot about here, but it's really important. That is the public health system. And so the public health system is what is out there ensuring that we have clean water to drink and safe food to eat. And that makes a difference. And in many ways, the medical care system and the public health system have been kind of detached from each other. And I think one of the real opportunities that we have is where can we find places to start to pull this together? And so, providing clean, you know, make sure the air is clean, the water is clean. That's for the public health system. Taking care of really sick patients, the medical care system should do that. But in terms of how do you provide vaccines for a population, how do you ensure that you have people engaged in physical activity? I think that's where integrating the two worlds come together. And I do think that telehealth is going to play a big role in providing the tools for that integration. That, yes, it's going to be important for me as a primary care provider to be able to monitor my patient with diabetes and to get those glucometer readings getting sent over the wire to me. That's going to be terrific. But boy, you know, it's going to be really great that we can interact with, for example, their employer around their employee health benefit and ensure that they're sending in their Fitbit readings at the same time. I think telehealth is going to allow us to integrate that. And so when I think about the use case of the future, I actually think the use case of the future is way over on the left side. I think that it's just reminding ourselves, and there's some work that I did with some Dartmouth colleagues, including Gene Nelson and business school colleagues, Richard Bomer, that just did an analysis of how patients spend their time. And I always remind myself that, you know, a patient with diabetes comes in, and maybe if they've got a lot going on, they're going to spend 90 minutes a year with me. But boy, they're spending, you know, 90 minutes a week doing various things to manage. And when you think about it, who's really managing their disease? And who are these tools going to be for? So I think we're moving forward. When we started, you know, in the past, we talked about enabling secondary and tertiary care where it wasn't available. At the present time, we're trying to cover a lot of the spectrum. But now we're going to shift, I think, way over to the left and allowing patients to really, really be part of their care and direct their care and keep them out of our healthcare system. And the real reason for this is we all remember, you know, you learned this in public health school or nursing school or medical school, and that is that what we do in healthcare, and this is just such a sobering slide, I always remind myself, what we do in healthcare, the care that we provide, is about 10% of the determinant of health. You ask people what makes them healthy, what we do at a wonderful place like the Mass General is about 10, or maybe we'll be generous, 15% of that comes from the health care they receive. But a lot of it comes from their habits, right? Their 40%. A lot of it comes from their living situation. A lot of it comes from their social circumstances. Oh, by the way, you know, there's a significant portion, probably about 30%, you know, that Mike McGinnis and his colleagues estimated that comes from your genetics. What can we do with the rest, right? So we focus so much on the temporal. I think the future of telehealth is going to be focusing on the rest. It's going to be focusing on those other things because that's where the real opportunity is going to be. And you're already seeing a lot of this. And, you know, high tech, well, it's not really high tech anymore, right? Cell phones are not high tech, right? Cell phones are just, they're part of our landscape. They are ubiquitous. And they're becoming relatively cheap. Think about how much, if you inflated, you know, the cost of building the Logan Medical Station up to $2015, how many cell phones with health apps could you buy? You could probably buy literally thousands of cell phones for the cost of that one place. So it's becoming relatively cheap, and it's becoming a really disruptive substitute. And I think that's the real future here. And many of you, you know, follow this world much more closely than I, but I just chose a couple of examples. And I was struck by an article in The Economist just a couple of months ago. And what it said is it talked about healthcare reform and the changes in the way we're delivering care. And the conclusion it reached was many companies see the disruption unleashed by the reforms as the business opportunity of a lifetime. So there's a lot that's going to be coming out real soon. And you've already experienced some of the work that Walgreens does with Theranos, with that, you know, the single drop of blood that you can do multiple tests on. And oh, by the way, you can have something that hooks onto a smartphone and actually can run that test over it. Cohealo is kind of a cool idea, right? So right now, there are probably about four or five ventilators sitting up in the up in the gray building right now that aren't being used out in the hallway. Like Airbnb allows you to use your home to open it up to somebody that needs a room to stay, Cohealo allows hospitals to share equipment. That is going to be pretty disruptive to supply chains. Kairos, we're working with Kairos right now to create an ability for folks to find primary care doctors. How many people here know Virtuell? Yeah, so a few do. Virtuell is an app you can get on your phone. And it's mainly done through employers, but you can do it on your own as well. What virtual allows you to do is you woke up in the morning, you have a sore throat, you don't feel so good, you go on to virtual, you go fill out a little structured questionnaire, an evidence-based medicine questionnaire about your symptoms. You hold the phone 12 inches away, you're instructed, take the picture, you send it, it goes to an MP, that MP looks at the algorithm and says, yep, you meet the criteria, you need to go on antibiotics. They have access to your allergies because you did that when you signed up for virtual. They know where you are because your phone told them where you are. They know what your health plan is, and they can tell you your prescription is waiting for you at the CVS, which we know is right around the corner from you. Right? That's pretty amazing. As a primary care doc, I think one third to half of what I do is going to be replaced by this. Not in the next 20 years. This isn't Tom Swift's picture phone that's going to come 5 decades later. This is coming in the next 5 years. It's coming fast. Vitals is a site that actually allows you to, when I send a patient, I say, you need an MRI. If they are an employer that works with Vitals, Vitals will tell them, okay, you need an MRI. We think you shouldn't go to Mass General Imaging because, boy, it's going to be too expensive. We're going to send you to Shields. And by the way, here's your taxi fare. You can use this, or here's your Uber. You can go ahead and use this to go over there. And by the way, for doing that, we're going to pay you for it. We're going to actually pay you a premium for going to the lower cost place. We're going to pay your transport, and we're going to give you some money back on that. What's interesting is that there actually was just a court case in the last few weeks because people were saying, well, is that kind of legal? Is that an inducement? And the court said, this is okay. This is okay. So I think that's going to unleash a lot of others. Another one, the general focus is going to be much more on health maintenance and monitoring, but it's also going to be on public health integration. And the slide on the right is one that I hope that you're going to look at sometime in the next few years. The slide on the right is actually an application attached to Epic. And the application is called What's Going Around, WGA. There's a little tab, it just says WGA. WGA was actually was put together by a former Mass General ID fellow, Ari Robashek. Ari works out the North Shore Health System in Illinois. What it does is it constantly collects the data on Epic every day of the diagnosis being seen. It allows me as a primary care doctor to see somebody with a GI illness and say, boy, is there something like norovirus going around in my community? I can look at the map and see how likely that is, or I can look and see what's going on with influenza. Real time, putting together the geo-mapping, the data coming out of Epic, and making it available to me, making public health intelligence available to me at the point of care. And I think, again, that is a powerful, powerful integration that we're going to see. So with all that said, I hope we got enough out there to stir up a few questions. I think for all of us, it's time to buckle our seatbelts. Things are moving quite quickly. And I always remind myself of what Darwin advised. It's not the strongest of the species, nor the most intelligent that survives. It is the one that is the most adaptable to change. We got changes ahead. Thank you.
That was terrific, Gregg, and as always, very provocative. We're going to transition now to our panel. So I'm going to ask Dr. Ami Bhatt from the MGH Cardiology Service to come up, along with Julie DaCosta, and who is a patient of Dr. Bhatt's and also works for a large employer, and Peggy McRae, who is the Director of Cardiovascular Services for Central Maine Medical Center, which is a hospital system that we've partnered with to provide a variety of telehealth services. So maybe we could start just by, we'll start with Peggy and go this way. If you could just say a few sentences about your relationship with the telehealth program and a little bit about the work that you do, sort of your role in your health system.
Sure. So we've actually been partnering with Mass General since 2011, starting our telestroke program in our emergency department. Central Maine Medical Center is a 250-bed hospital in Lewiston, Maine. We are a tertiary care facility, but within Central Maine Healthcare, we also have two other critical access hospitals in rural areas of parts of Maine, and we collaborate with another hospital, a smaller hospital on the coast of Maine. What we found is that we were not providing the best care we could for our stroke patients. We didn't many of our patients did not receive TPA. We didn't have access to a neurologist 24/7 at all of our sites, so this was an opportunity for us to really provide better care. At that time, I was in the emergency department, the director for the emergency department, so I was able to facilitate the start of that program, which we've now subsequently expanded not only to telestroke, but teleneurology. We're utilizing it in-house, in our critical care areas, in our med-surg areas, to be able to provide services for our patients.
That's great. We'll be coming back with additional questions, and maybe Julie, you could say a few words about why you're here in this capacity and a little bit about your role at your job.
Sure. My name is Julie DeCosta. I'm a patient of Dr. Botts, and we've used the telehealth for some appointments. I am also the Director of Human Resources for Verizon Wireless, and so I take care of a lot of 2,000 employees here in the New England market, and teach at Emmanuel College in the HR Master's program.
Great, and I think I saw on here you might also be part of one of our patient and family advisory councils.
I am. Just this year, I've been accepted and serve on that board for the general PFAC.
Great, well, thank you so much. And Dr. Bott, you want to introduce yourself?
Sure. My first name is Ami. So I direct the Adult Congenital Heart Disease Program here at Mass General. We take care of people who were born with heart disease and have made it through childhood and living in adulthood, ages 16 through, I saw an 80-year-old before coming down here. And it's interesting because it's a population who is very active still. So these are people in school who are working, who have families to care for, but end up coming all the way to Boston to Mass General to see us for care because it's such a tertiary, subspecialized field. And so for us, getting into telemedicine last year was really important because we'd like to provide tertiary level care in the areas where they live. And it's gone well, and I guess we'll talk more about it in a bit.
Great. And Gregg, do you want to talk at all about your interactions when you were at Dartmouth or here around telehealth as a provider?
Yeah, so I would say two things. I think that for me personally, as somebody who is still fancy themselves as a part-time primary care clinician, these tools are incredibly exciting. And when I think about what we're doing in population health management, and we can talk about the high-risk care management program and what we're trying to do in terms of virtual visits and rolling out behavioral health integration, when I think about, why are we doing that? Well, there are some market reasons why we're doing that, and you read about that in the paper. But the real reason we're doing it is because that's the way I've always dreamed about practicing medicine. Like the notion that patients have to be inconvenienced and take time off of work or get someone to watch their kids to come in and see me, that doesn't feel good. It's not what we want. And so one of the things I got to experience at Dartmouth was how this applies in a rural community, but we also were pushing quite hard on using virtual visits in our primary care practice up there. And I look forward to working with Joe and the Connected Health folks and all of you here at Mass General on what the vision should be and the future should be of telehealth for Partners Healthcare.
Great. So let me, I'll start it off with a question or two, and then I would encourage anyone in the audience that has a question they'd like to ask, just raise your hand, and we have a microphone we can bring to you, and I'll repeat your question in case others didn't hear it. So I guess let me start with the issue of the physician or the provider-patient relationship, which is obviously something that's really central to our mission and we don't want to sacrifice. And so I would ask maybe each of you to just comment on, from your experience, do you feel like the telemedicine interactions you've been a part of are a sort of poor substitute for the physician-patient interaction but are overcome by convenience, or whether they actually engage or further the physician-patient relationship? Is it a compromise, or in your experience, has it actually been a new kind of way to interact with your doctor? And I guess for Peggy to start with you, as a outside provider looking to have a meaningful presence from a tertiary care service, when that doctor beams in from Mass General on the TV, does it feel like they're there and that there's a real relationship with the patients, or does it really feel like it's good enough but not what it would be in person?
Actually, it does feel like they're there, and it's really a nice it's a really nice adjunct to us to be able to deliver care, because then we have the expertise that we might not have right there, but it allows that physician at the bedside still to be able to communicate and provide care for the patient, but know that they have a resource available. So it's not been a compromise. It's actually the opportunity for us to be able to provide care when the patient needs care.
What do you think, Julie?
I was getting this question before today, and of course I had a relationship with Dr. Bott face-to-face before we did this. I think that would be important. For me, it was important. The interaction made the relationship stronger, but as a patient, I appreciated having the relationship prior to going into that experience.
So you think that as an adjunct to an in-person visit, it doesn't feel like a poor substitute, but that if you'd never met Dr. Bott in person, it might have felt a little different? I mean, she projects so amazingly well through any medium.
She tells me to exercise more, so. Yeah, I think it was an addition to, you know, I don't think it took away from, but I would have wanted that face-to-face interaction prior to going into the...
And do you think of these as visits, or are these more like a phone call with a face on the other end? Does this feel like a healthcare visit, and if you had to pay a copay every time you did one of these, would it suddenly feel different, or is this just a visit that's super convenient for you?
Yeah, it's a visit that's super convenient, but I would pay a copay for that visit. Yeah, I would feel comfortable with that.
And Ami, how about you? What's your experience been like doing this with other patients as well?
Yeah, so one thing about Julie, and then in general, so I'm a hugger and Julie is not. So for that reason, I think she's
so
very
it might be a benefit.
Yeah, exactly. She's not saying it, but she likes for that reason. So from my perspective, I make eye contact with people again. And it is glorious to make eye contact again. So unfortunately, or fortunately, we do a lot on the computer now. We do billing, we do notes, and to get through my day with the volume of practice that I have, I have to type. I have to type. It's part of the way I practice now. And to get through the day, I do that. And now I get to see people. And they're right there, and I can look them in the eye, and I'm getting good at typing and listening to what they're saying and almost transcribing sometimes. But other times, I can just put my hands down and I can talk. And that's partly because they're there, I'm here. It's partly because they're in their home and relaxed and comfortable with their family, and I'm a little bit more engaged than I am in the white room with the, you know, awkward sheet, and they're in a gown, and I don't really, you know, they're in their pajamas, their kids are there. I feel more comfortable. So perhaps I'm a little more engaged sometimes, oddly enough, and in a personal but not medical way. So it's nice. I really like that. Can I provide the kind of care that I do in person when somebody is short of breath? I can't do this, right? So there are certain, me being a cardiologist, times where it's not gonna be the same as an in-person visit. But for a lot of the other things, and you know, for Julie now versus, if you don't mind my saying it, Julie 3 years ago, virtual visits now for us are great. Perhaps 3 years ago we were in a tougher place and that wouldn't have done for either her or for me. So I think it's for the right patient at the right time as well.
I would say for me, the comments made earlier by Mr. Koster remind me of that old adage, right? You don't want to meet your primary care doctor looking up from a gurney. It's not a good time to meet your primary. And I don't think you probably want to meet your doctor on a video screen for the first time either. And I think that idea of having an opportunity to establish a relationship first is really powerful. I do think that we need to be broad-minded when we think about it in terms of what value it brings, because yes, it is a substitute for face-to-face visits, but we always should remind ourselves that these technologies are also a substitute for telephone calls. And so you gotta think about because that really, there's a huge upside compared to a telephone call. Yeah. We don't often talk about that. We talk about what are we missing from the face-to-face visit as opposed to what are we gaining from a telephone visit. Yeah. And the second thing I think to think about is to move beyond thinking about this as this is a substitute for work that I would do in another way. As a lot of these, you know, some of the technologies I was showing at the end, these are things that are enhancements. You know, this is work that we weren't able to do before, and now we're going to have data and we're going to have, you know, the ability to interact in different ways that didn't exist. And so having access to patients' wellness and other data in real time, that's a total enhancement. That's a sub, because we just haven't done that. We wanted to, but we haven't. So that's a total enhancement.
I mean, I'm very much in your camp about the idea of enabling self-care, and I actually view this telehealth capability is really supporting my patients' self-care. And I also love being in people's living rooms. I mean, what I've learned about my patients and their home environments and their family and their kids, and I get to meet and see parts of their life that I never got to see in the office. But I remember I was talking to somebody, a guy named Jack Ansel at BU, who's done a lot of work on patient self-management with anticoagulation and patients monitoring their own INR. And he has this great thing. He says, you know, if insulin was a drug we gave 2 or 3 times a year, it would be this deadly drug that no patient could ever touch themselves. Because you got to give it like 4 times a day. Well, of course the patients do it because, you know, we can't see them 4 times a day. Same thing with managing anticoagulation. I think really managing your health is something that we really do trust patients to do, but then don't provide them with the tools to do it well. And so I see this lowering the bar between do I really need to see the doctor and can I see the provider when I need it? When I have a critical decision to make, should I use my inhaler or not? Should I do this? Should I do that? Is this rash, a cellulitis, or is it just something not to worry about? So much of what we do is come in at the end when the problem is already, you know, knee deep and now they need an admission. We really want to be upstream, and I think some of it will be apps, like Gregg says, it'll be passive monitoring, activity monitoring, weight monitoring, but some of it will just be answering an important question at the right time. Ami, you wanted to say something.
I was actually going to say, along the lines of empowering patients, one way that we have used it is we do a lot of imaging in cardiology, lots of pictures of the heart, and then you get a letter in the mail that has a lot of words that you don't understand, and then at the top I write, great job, with like a smiley face, right? And so that's our current method of communication. So we've started scheduling a televisit after your exam where I share my desktop, and I can now circle and put little red marks, and the smiley face goes on the screen, but I can show people. And so in terms of education and I think empowering people to understand their disease process better, understanding what you have goes a long way to being empowered to care for yourself, I think. So that's been helpful as well.
I want to comment on that. Dr. Bott and I did that. I saw her face, she saw my face, and the report that we were reviewing was there. And it really gave me confidence at the end of the visit. What she was saying on the numbers that I was seeing, even though I might not have fully understood, just gave me confidence that, oh yes, everything is okay. So that was really a benefit.
We are working on an adapter with 2 arms that you can put on the laptop, reach out and hug remotely.
I won't be buying that adapter.
Yes, your patient will not be purchasing that.
No.
Any questions from the audience at the moment? Thoughts? Dr. Khan? Someone's coming with a microphone for you. So if you could just say your name and then your question.
Sure, my name's Alistair Khan. I have a question and it concerns, as we move into this new way of delivering care, a couple of things come up. Number one is obvious, which is, do you need now to maintain a license in Maine and New Hampshire? Have the bureaucrats caught up yet? And the second one is, how do you record this? Can you just tape the entire thing, download the video to the medical record, and you're done? Because we're gonna get there, right? Or do you make notes and type them up?
So those are terrific questions, and let me, I'll take a shot at providing an answer to that and then ask others to talk as well. We still live in the 1950s from a regulatory perspective, and the courts have made it clear that care is rendered where the patient is located. So if the patient's in New Hampshire and I'm in Massachusetts, I'm giving care to a patient in New Hampshire. And so that means that I either need to be licensed to provide care in the state of New Hampshire, or I need to fit in under what's considered an exception to the Board of Registration's rules around when you need a license and when you don't. And there are exceptions like Good Samaritan statutes. If someone has a car accident, they're on the side of the road and you come up, you don't have to be licensed in that state to provide resuscitation. You probably don't have to have a license if they're in international waters, you know, in their fishing boat 1.5 miles off the coast. There's an interesting question about whether or not, if it's an established patient of yours and they happen to live in New Hampshire and they call your office on the phone with a strep throat and you prescribe an antibiotic, we do that all the time, and we're not licensed in New Hampshire when we make that medical prescription. So there's some flexibility around that, and the MGH at least has made the determination that once you have an established relationship with your patient and you've seen them in person face to face, We are using telehealth now to render follow-up care wherever your patient might be. If they're international, there are some additional concerns because some countries have separate rules and regulations around the use of telemedicine. So the short answer to number one is, if you're going to be providing new care, episodic care, like the stroke program we have, all of our doctors who render care in that program are licensed in the state where the hospital is located and privileged with a limited credentialing around telemedicine services at the facility level. So we do that. Now, there's no such restriction around care in the home. So you don't have to be credentialed to deliver care in the home. You just have to be licensed in the state. As far as documenting what you do, I love the idea that in the future someday there'd just be the video, you know, encounter living in the cloud somewhere, accessible if someone wants to view it. But I think we'll always still need a brief digest of what happened, because all of our population health tools and management tools rely on being able to work against structured data. And, you know, maybe in the future Google will actually record the whole thing, transcribe it for you, and you'll just edit it and approve it. That'd be kind of nice, so you didn't have to spend the whole time jotting everything down. But I think your impression of the encounter and your plan will still need to be documented in a way that people could grapple with. But I think that's a new startup was just born. Dr. Khan's video translator. Greg, you have any thoughts about that?
I agree with you, all your comments about the need for a federal solution. I think the problem is that medical licensure is still state authority in the United States, and so it will require federal legislation to do that, and it would probably get tied up in the courts for a while too, but it's time to do it. I can honestly tell you that there are programs that we wanted to extend out of Dartmouth-Hitchcock that communities didn't want. The communities needed them, because patients were not getting care they needed. And they were delayed literally by months and months because of these licensure issues. So it's taking a toll now. And I think as that becomes more visible, hopefully we'll get some federal action. And I think, you know, the one thing always to remember is that, you know, that video document is wonderful for you because then you'll know exactly what happened. But I'm seeing the patient after you. And with all due respect, Alistair, you're a nice guy and you're good looking, but I don't want to watch a movie of you for 15 minutes to figure out what happened. I want to get a very crisp summary. And so we still have to do that.
You know, one thing I would point out, Greg, you've practiced in the military. In the military, there is no such restriction. Yeah. Any physician privileged to provide care in the armed services can provide anywhere. It to any service member anywhere in the United States or in the world at any time. So, and same with the VA. So there are precedents for this, and I think there has been several bills introduced in the Senate about creating a single federal licensure for physicians, but it's met a lot of opposition from boards of registration and, interestingly, chambers of commerce. Not surprising. Do you want to say something about that, Peggy? So another area that I think is worth maybe all of us talking about and thinking about is the transitions of care. And we've all come to recognize that leaving the hospital before you, kind of returning home, before you've seen your primary care doctor, if you're lucky enough to have one, or going from the hospital to the skilled nursing facility to the next destination. These are really vulnerable periods of time, and I wonder if any of the panelists want to think about how might telehealth, do you think there's a role for telehealth in trying to help support these transitions in care in a way that would reduce the risk to patients?
So our pediatric ICU colleagues actually have been working in this realm. And there is some pediatric work throughout the country talking about transitioning young babies home from the ICU, transitioning them to another institution, and the use of telemedicine. And so in the pediatric world, there we are, we do see that. And so I think that's important. You know, one interesting part for us for looking at heart failure patients and seeing them go home, go to rehab, it's helpful to see them at rehab to be able to help. But one place that we're not yet using it, and hopefully we will, is when you first see the doctor who referred you to a tertiary center or who ended up with you in a hospital, and now you're in that primary care's office, that general cardiologist's office, and you're trying to put everything together from all of those papers and the discharge summaries that multiple people wrote, oftentimes people who didn't actually see the patient but were on the day of discharge and therefore tried to glom something together because they were responsible for the paperwork. Sorry to say, but this does happen, right? So if you had one of the doctors involved in someone's care in hospitalization when you have that two-week follow-up visit. I think that's a very vulnerable time where the presence of somebody who was there could really help both that patient's care, but even that patient's relationship and faith in the original doctor who sent them in for a long hospitalization and now is on the receiving end again.
Yeah. A couple of additional comments. I think places like Mass General and Central Maine Medical Center are blessed and burdened by really superb nursing staff. And for all of us who've either ourselves or had loved ones who've been cared for in these places, when they leave that facility, you just stepped into an abyss because you had all this terrific care and also you feel that you're suddenly adrift. And I do think that when we look at, you know, what the risks are, we know that the modal day for readmission in the Medicare population in the United States is about 2 days. And so that notion of you're going to see the primary care physician in a week, that doesn't work so well. And so being able to extend these programs and being also able to follow the patients over the continuum of care. There's a, you know, I think a great pilot that was done at the Brigham of patients who were in the Brigham ICU who are now at Spalding and who are actually being followed by their ICU team using telehealth. So for the patient and the family that had all of that care wrapped around them so tightly when they were at the Brigham and then took that giant leap to the next step in their care, the notion that the team is still involved in their care and they can see them, that's a pretty powerful thing. And I think that we ought to be able to leverage that a little bit more widely than we have so far.
Great. Other questions from the audience? Benji, did you have a question?
I do. So Benji Meller, I work on the telehealth team, so I'm very much embedded in this every day. And we see the benefits, those of us who work in the field every day. But what I'm curious about is, do you feel that patients are looking for this? And would love to get the patient perspective too. As we move more and more into the future, we use apps, we use video conferencing in our everyday lives. Are patients looking for this in healthcare, or do we just see ways that this will be beneficial and we're bringing it to the system?
From a convenience standpoint, it's ideal. You know, I didn't have to drive in to Boston that day. I saw Dr. Bart a few weeks earlier. The test results weren't ready, so she said, let's do this. So from the convenience standpoint, I think patients are looking for it. From an employer standpoint, if it keeps employees at work and they don't call out sick and they can talk to their doctor from their home in the morning and come in for their afternoon shift, I think that's ideal. You know, I think patients and employees would pay for that as well if they didn't have to truck into the doctor's office and miss work.
Ben?
Hi, great discussion. Ben Crocker, Ambulatory Practice of the Future. I'm a primary care physician. We take care primarily of employers ourselves, and we've done a lot of telephone care, over 6,000 telephone visits over the last few years with a handful of doctors. And so the question that always arises, I think, among our team is the value of telephone versus telehealth. And so, Julie, I've got a question for you more around, if you were to see your primary care physician, I can understand in the tertiary world where you're seeing your specialist, you may not see Dr. Bott, hopefully not that often, but you might see your PCP a little bit more often with issues. How comfortable would you feel in connecting with your team through telephone only versus the need for the telehealth connection, the video connection? Where would the value of that be for you personally? And would you be willing to pay for a connection with protected time, communication, and the ability to be heard and listened? And I think, like Ami, I'm a hugger, but I also love to just have time with patients. And sometimes what we find is just having that time to really truly listen to patients, be it through telephone or video connection, we've done both. We find that, at least in the employee population, that because our schedules are so relatively crazy on both ends, that the telephone is a very valuable tool without the complications of connecting by video. So we would be interested in your thoughts.
I think I never really thought of the telephone call with the doctor and the telehealth visit as you know, two different things, but as you point that out, I sort of see it's just access, you know. I may pay for a telehealth because that's a visit to me. Maybe it's more in-depth, it's discussing something specific. A telephone call might be, you know, a quick check-in. How's that new medication working for you? I don't want to pay for that as a patient or a consumer. But I sort of see them now, as you pointed out, as two different things. Maybe accomplishing the same thing, but maybe not accomplishing the same thing. That answer?
Yeah, I want to make a comment about that, because I think this addresses, there's two important aspects to this. What we want to achieve is a seamless escalation of whatever connection or communication method we need to address the problem. So I would like to think that in the future, it might start with a phone call. And if both parties feel that the needs can be met with a brief phone interaction, you're done. But if there's something of concern, you can escalate. And ideally through the same communication environment, you just like push a button and suddenly it goes to video, or you push another button and even maybe an ambulance goes out. In other words, there's just, the tools serve us. We don't have to change our workflow to meet the limitations of the tools we have. I think the other part about what video ads over the telephone, for me, it's there's three things. One of them is that the nonverbal information is important to me. When the patient tells me that they're having a chest pain or headache or some symptom that might be concerning, I really want to look at their face. I want to see the expression. I want to see how they're holding their body. I think we all do this in the office all the time with that. So what we're on attending rounds, you don't even have to touch the patient or even talk. You're just watching. And so there's clearly, in neurology especially, there's a lot of information that's conveyed nonverbally, but I think in all of us. So there's a piece there of validation. When the patient says they have a 10 out of 10 headache, and you look at them and they're chatting and smiling and look at ease, that's discordant for you. I think the second is, and we all know this from the conference calls we spend endless hours on while we're checking our email and eating our lunch, that being on the phone is no guarantee that you have someone's attention. But when they're looking at you on a screen, they can't be reading their email at the same time and pretending like they're on the call. So I think part of what the video forces is a non-distracted exchange. And I know what Ami was saying about sometimes you're less distracted on the video than even you are in person. Because in person, people can be knocking on your door, the nurse could be interrupting you. Other things could be happening in a way that in the video visit might even be more private and more intentional. So I think there are other attributes to this. Where we get in trouble, I think, is if we're going to pay for video and not for phone calls. We don't want to create a scenario where we're driving behavior towards something because there's a financial incentive. We'd rather say, here's $1,000 to manage, you know, your patient's care for the next 3 months. Do it any way you can that is going to meet your needs, and create financial incentives to actually do it in the least expensive way that still meets the needs of whatever we pick. And we need to pick metrics that are sensitive to the things patients care about as a way to make sure that we're not just providing cheap care, that we're actually providing high value care.
Could I ask a question? As we're talking about payment, so United Healthcare comes out and says, we support telemedicine, we pay for telemedicine. What does that mean, and are other insurance companies or Medicare and Medicaid in line, or is this not in our future?
So you get a nickel and a big hug every time you do one of these? And so you'll be okay with that, yeah. We don't really know yet what that means, and there are the American Telemedicine Association just released a wonderful report that was a state-by-state report card around telehealth, and one of the important metrics in the report card is called it's called telehealth parity, insurance parity, P-A-R-I-T-Y, which means what do you pay for a telehealth visit compared to the same diagnostic E&M code you would pay for in-person? And the states that get high ratings on their report cards pay equal. So they're making the statement, look, you know, an hour of a doctor's time is an hour of a doctor's time, or whatever that level of complexity was, should be valued the same. Now, you might imagine there'll be some discounting associated over the long term because the actual cost of providing a telehealth visit at scale is cheaper than an in-person visit. So I think the answer is that we should be pushing hard for telehealth reimbursement to scale with some kind of relative value approach to what it means to manage a patient and with complexity and time. And we should not let ourselves be caught in a race to the bottom where, you know, it's great that the United's going to pay for it, but they're going to pay $10 a visit. That would be a real loss, I think, for us. I think the big win here is in population health management, in that if we change the way we pay for things, then it's Gregg who has to decide how much to pay you for that visit, not United Health, and we have much greater chance of having an influence and an appropriate, making our case appropriately to Gregg than we do to the, you know, CEO of United Healthcare. So we have time for just one or two more questions. Oh, yes, in the back there.
I work in the neurofibromatosis clinic here at MGH with Scott Plotkin, and so neurofibromatosis is a relatively rare disease, and as one of the few NF clinics in the country, we have patients coming from all around the country and the world and who've asked us to look into telemedicine because it's such a burden to get here from California or India. But we've struggled with how to think about what types of visits would be most suited for telemedicine without losing the personal connection. And so I wanted to know, just how do you think of what kinds of visits are most appropriate for a telehealth visit versus which you really need to come here for in person, and how to juggle that?
So I have thoughts, but let me just ask the panelists if anyone else wants to make some comments on that first.
So I see Sarah Sasang sitting here in the front, and she directs our telehealth program. There was a box of four things that we were looking at, the way we think about MGH telehealth. And we talked about synchronous versus asynchronous visits, right? And it's interesting because the question you're asking is the one I started asking in the beginning. I said, who needs to come in and be seen face-to-face here so I can lay on, right, my hands, as a doctor should, and who still gets good care from afar? And what I realized, to my surprise and somewhat dismay, was that the laying on of hands was actually not, in many cases, as important as I thought it was going to be for providing that care. So obviously it's a case-to-case basis. What I didn't realize, and this is why I refer to that 4x4 graph, and you may want to meet Sarah and get a copy of that, is that the concept of synchronous versus asynchronous, seeing the patient in a virtual visit and doing things versus sending them questionnaires, information, getting other data back, doing e-consults with their local physicians, was an area that I didn't even think of as doctoring. And it turns out that that is actually quite helpful to local physicians, to patients, and to myself in maintaining a relationship, understanding what the care is, without having to even see each other face-to-face all the time. So all of a sudden, my connection with these patients is better because I had several asynchronous or email communication, e-consults along the way. And then I could figure out, okay, based on how it's going, you and I can see each other over the televisit, we're going to do okay. Or, wow, based on how that's going, maybe you should come out here. The new patient is still hard. The new patient is hard because it's hard for you to know. And it also depends on the patient. There are some patients who are not going to want you to not lay on the hands for the first visit. And that is a challenge, and that requires getting to know who they are and their patients. And I don't have an answer for that. Maybe Lee does, for that brand new patient and how you do it. But for the known patients, I'd say you'll be surprised how many times you need to lay on hands. And it's a little bit, again, a little bit of dismay when I learned that. But the asynchronous is also very helpful. Lee, I don't know if you want to address the new patient and how to approach that.
So I think there's a nice way to think about this is with what's going on in higher education. So you can go to an Ivy League school that will educate 5,000 students a year in a really wonderful, enriched, intense environment, and will produce a really high quality experience for those 5,000 people. So if you think about that as kind of fee-for-service, that's like concierge medicine, right? You take 5,000 people and you really pay attention to them for 4 years. But you are leaving 3 billion people who want education without access to anything. And so pushing education out over digital media that allow people to, at their own pace, experience something that's not quite that level, but is so much far above what they have access to in their own environment, that if you wanted to manage the educational needs of a population, you would clearly say that this would be 80% of what you would do. So I would say it's really about the comparative paucity of resources for that person in their local environment. If they're the CEO of a corporation and they have a private jet and they can fly here whenever they want to, a lot of their care they may choose to seek here in person, but for most of these patients with limited resources, having virtual visits and asynchronous exchange of information, even just to decide if it's appropriate for them to, do you have something to offer beyond what they have in their community? And connecting with their doctors in their community would be huge. You could manage five times the number of patients in your clinic if you could make use of these tools. And if we paid you to manage them and not forced you to collect reimbursement only when they showed up on your doorstep, you'd quickly discover you could be much more efficient and provide pretty effective care to lots more patients and identify the ones who were not staying on the projected course as the ones who need to come and see you. So I think that we're getting better at this, and I believe with Gregg that this is not a linear equation. This is an exponential equation. We're going to hit some tipping point, and suddenly the opportunities are going to go stratospheric, because in their neighborhood there'll be a CVS with a booth that has a 3D holographic camera, and they'll walk in, and you can do even more of it. You could do in a complete skin exam in the privacy of this booth that you can't do right now with a webcam. They'll be wearing a watch that will allow you to measure all sorts of vital signs that you feel like you missed the chance to measure when they came in the office. So I think we have work to do to disintegrate the visit and decide which are the parts that are critical that have to happen with me there, which parts can happen done by someone else as long as they're assembled for me when I see the patient. And I still think 90% of the care we provide that's non-procedural is cognitive and can be done with the patient in a way that we have their full and undivided attention and their family members' attention, but not requiring us to be the ones who are laying the hands on. And the last thing I'll emphasize is the family. The family can't afford to all fly here. So when the further the patient is from where you are, the fewer the important people you get coming to the appointment. And the ability of telehealth, something I've just started to do, is the patient's in my office, but the daughter is over video at home or at her job or somewhere else in Florida, but wants to be part of the visit and doesn't want to just get a letter or a quick phone call at the end, wants to be there to chime in when mom is not telling what she believes is the full picture of her illness experience.
So I agree with those are terrific comments, and Ami, what you said as well is that that I think that as providers we probably often overrate our
contribution,
and there are two things that make me think that. One of them is that there's now an emerging literature. The latest studies were on cognitive behavioral therapy, and there was a head-to-head cognitive behavioral therapy done virtually versus in person. Virtual was just as good, maybe better, particularly with adolescents who are uncomfortable being face-to-face with somebody. They took it one step further, and they looked at cognitive behavioral therapy delivered by a real live psychiatrist versus cognitive behavioral therapy with a very sophisticated avatar. The avatar actually did marginally better. Interesting.
They could relate more to the avatar.
I think the more powerful piece here, though, is going to be, especially with a community like your patient community, what they're going to be able to do among themselves. And so I think about patients like me, which I'm sure many of your patients are on right now, the big white wall, which is used for managing depression in a lot of places. The work that Dan Hoke did way ahead of his time here, getting patients with seizure disorder to all of a sudden start caring for each other and allowing him to step back and moderate. And so I think that that's going to be another powerful aspect of this. So yes, we struggle with how we ought to interact with that patient, but I think we need to be very broad-minded about all the ways that they really can get help.
Yeah. Great. Well, thank you to everybody. Let's give a warm round of applause to our panelists. If you'd like to be on our contact list, there's a clipboard over by the beverages. Please feel free to stay around. We have the space until 5 if you want to grab a refreshment, talk to one of the panelists or one of the audience members. And thank you all so much for spending your time with us today.